The ocean, as we know, teems with fish and other marine life. According to scientists, it has the potential to sustain humanity for hundreds, if not thousands, of years. Yet, in adventure novels about daring seafarers crossing seas and oceans, even circumnavigating the globe, we often read about sailors who faced starvation. They were forced to eat their boots, suffered from scurvy, and endured other hardships. But why? All they needed to do, it seems, was cast a fishing line and catch enough fish for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Let's explore why this wasn't so simple. During the age of exploration, the times of Ferdinand Magellan, Christopher Columbus, and Vasco da Gama, sailors' logs often mentioned a peculiar phenomenon. They described abundant catches of fish, only to find them inedible. For example, Antonio Pigafetta, Magellan's cartographer, wrote in his journal about catching a lot of fish that were later thrown overboard. The same logs mention the death of about 40 crew members. Sailors were puzzled by these unfamiliar fish, but even familiar species sometimes turned out to be deadly. Who would expect that eating an ordinary sea bass or tuna could be fatal? A common belief held that only herbivorous fish could be poisonous, while predators were safe to eat. But this assumption hid a dangerous truth. Any fish could be lethally toxic. Sailors tried various methods to ensure their catch was safe. The devout Spaniards sprinkled holy water on the fish, hoping it would protect them. They placed silver coins or crosses on the catch. If the silver tarnished, the fish was discarded. Freshly caught fish were left on the deck. If flies landed on it, it was deemed edible. If not, the entire catch, no matter how plentiful, was thrown overboard. Even as far back as the 7th century BCE, Chinese doctors documented mysterious deaths following the consumption of certain fish. It wasn't until 1866 that Cuban physician Felipe Poe identified the cause, ciguatera poisoning. This illness occurs when humans eat fish or shellfish contaminated with ciguatoxins, poisonous compounds produced by certain plankton species. For marine life, these toxins are harmless. However, fish that consume the plankton accumulate the toxins in their bodies. Predatory fish like grouper, barracuda, and moray eels, which eat smaller fish, become carriers of even higher toxin levels. The older the fish, the more toxins it accumulates. The most troubling aspect is that cooking doesn't neutralize the toxin. Symptoms of ciguatera poisoning can appear within an hour: abdominal pain, vomiting, diarrhea, and in severe cases, respiratory failure or cardiovascular issues. Without timely medical intervention, death can occur. There is no specific antidote, so treatment involves managing the symptoms, similar to other forms of poisoning. During World War II, ciguatera reemerged as American soldiers reported fish poisoning incidents in the Pacific. Modern studies confirm about 50,000 cases of ciguatera poisoning annually, though the actual number could be much higher due to underreporting. Individual reactions to the toxin vary widely. Another reason for sailors' starvation lies in the ocean's uneven distribution of life. While some areas are teeming with fish, others are biological deserts. These oligotrophic regions, such as the centers of subtropical gyres at 30 to 40 degrees latitude, lack the nutrients needed to sustain large populations of marine life. This scarcity is due to atmospheric conditions. In these latitudes, winds transition from westerlies to easterly trade winds, creating near windless zones. Historical accounts of Atlantic trade routes between Africa and North America often mention the doldrums, where weak winds left ships adrift for days. Sailors in these regions frequently resorted to eating their horses or other livestock due to food shortages. The lack of wind also prevents nutrient-rich deep waters from mixing with surface waters. In most of the ocean, biologically available nitrogen and phosphorus come from the deep. When strong winds or storms disrupt the water column, these nutrients rise to the surface, fueling plankton blooms. Without these processes, nutrient levels remain critically low, suppressing phytoplankton growth, the foundation of the marine food chain. Satellite images of ocean color reveal these dead zones as regions with minimal chlorophyll concentrations, represented in dark purple tones. This low primary productivity cascades through the food web, leaving little marine life for human consumption. These biological deserts existed long before the age of exploration and persist today, shaped by large-scale atmospheric circulation patterns. Magellan's route around the globe highlights this issue. His expedition spent significant time crossing the South Pacific Gyre, a region of nearly zero productivity, according to satellite data. Here, weak winds and sparse marine life combined to create a deadly trap. Ships drifted in windless expanses, surrounded by an ocean incapable of sustaining them. The twin challenges of toxic fish and biological deserts explain why sailors often face starvation despite being surrounded by water. Understanding these phenomena not only sheds light on historical maritime hardships, but also highlights the intricate balance of oceanic ecosystems that continues to affect us today. Also, check out our other videos. The darkest place in the US, why people are fleeing it. The world's most dangerous islands you should avoid.